But I met the seer, and this man, his real name is Calle de Montségur. Calle de Montségur. I met him after I had been lying on a bed for 3 years, and this was in 1998. And since I was 15 years old, I've been studying all the world religions. But I had, at that time, never practiced anything. So that was really what, in the end, made me lay on a bed for 3 years without getting any diagnosis or whatever. Nobody could give me a diagnosis. Doctors or healers or clairvoyants or whatever. So, and you should imagine that in 3 years, you know, I was kind of crucified. It was a physical pain, and it was a psychic pain, you know, psychological pain. So I was really, it was like, if you could imagine, a bar of iron coming in here and out here. And I was like this, you know. And in the beginning, I was lying there for maybe a week, and then I had 2 or 3 days up. Then I had to go down again for 2 weeks. Then I was up for a few days, and then I was down again for, and it, you know, it seemed to be longer terms that I was lying there. And at times I couldn't even eat or drink or anything. At one time I had a glass of water just standing next to the bed. And I was thinking, when I was able to think, that in a minute I would drink, have something to drink, or have a biscuit or something to eat, but I couldn't. I couldn't even raise my hand or arm to reach out for it. So I was just lying there like in a complete coma kind of situation. And when I was able to think just the tiniest thought, I mean, I prayed to God. I had so many arguments with him, but it was a one-way communication because there was never any answer. You know, dear God, tell me what I have done wrong, and I will clear everything. I'll be the best boy in the whole wide world. I will never go with the girls. I will never smoke. I will never nothing. I mean, I'll be the exemplary boy in the whole wide world. But no answer. So after 3 years, and you should imagine my days were like exactly like if you were at the bottom of a mud hole and you're looking up, and every day is like a climb up towards the light, and just before you just get a hold on the to kind of get you up, you just lose the grip and you go down, and you have to wait until the next day or the day after. So suddenly one day it was grace really that came. There was a voice coming from somewhere. I never really understood where it came from or how, but the voice said, if you are lying here feeling so much pain that you are able to feel, why not take upon you the pain of everybody else in the world? And somehow it sounds crazy when I tell it to today, but somehow there was something in me that knew that if I didn't comply to this, I wouldn't get another chance. So I said yes, and it that exact moment I was kind of relieved. It was like I was standing beside myself, seeing myself lying there, and there was absolutely no pain. The week after, I got in contact with the seer. And of course, at that time, I didn't put two and two together. I didn't really think that those two events were connected. But of course there was. Because it was like me sending out a signal that now I'm ready. It was a friend of mine who phoned me up and asked me, because I had to attend some meetings that I couldn't, I mean, I never went to those meetings. So she asked me, Lars, why don't you attend these meetings? Are you not? Do you want? Don't want to be part of this anymore? Yes, yes, I said. But you must understand that I've been sick for 3 years. But because I have no diagnosis, I couldn't go come and tell you that I was sick of this or that. So that's the reason, really. Why didn't you call me? She said. I know a man that can fix this. And I got this telephone number and I phoned him up, and as you can read in the book, after a few times I got in contact with him. And within a 5 minute talk on the telephone, he cured me, more or less. And that was something, what I experienced there was something that I would experience many times in the years to come. And it felt like somebody was just knocking me, just very, very fragile in the neck. And afterwards, I got so tired, I went to sleep, and I woke up after 2 hours sleep, and felt that a world that for 3 years had been in black and white was now in technicolor. And that was exactly how it was. If you have ever tried to in the morning when you put on your shoes, you are in a hurry, and you can feel there's something, maybe a little stone, and think, oh, I don't mind. You try to, and you go out. But after something, the tiny stone can be, you know, really make you unable to go anywhere. And just think that you have been walking on that for 3 years, and suddenly somebody is so kind enough to remove it. It's just like that. He said to me that before he did this healing, he said, you can come and see me in half a year in Copenhagen, and until then everything will be all right and will be fixed. And after half a year I went there, and as you can read in the book, he had moved. And it wasn't there, but left me a telegram that told me to go to Montségur, the sacred mountain in southern France, where the Cathars had been roaming in 1200. So half a year later, I went there, and that was the start of the most amazing journey I ever have been on, because that was me meeting my teacher, my first real teacher. And if you imagine that I've been studying and reading all those books for years and years and years on end, without ever practicing anything. So I was what you would call a wandering library, you know. I knew everything, and I knew absolutely nothing. So meeting this guy was a complete different experience. This man had never read a book in his life. Yes, one. And that's the one I want to tell you about, the Book of Life. He was a master of reading the Book of Life. And as you know, the Book of Life is a metaphor for the Akashic records, or for the great, whatever you call it. The records where all the everything that we as humans give energy will leave a mark in the Book of Life. Everything that we give energy, I mean, not every thought, because we think every day so many thoughts we have lost track of them, but those that we give energy, like all the words we give energy, all our deeds we give energy, can be read there. And of course this was much too early for me to know anything about that. I have read a lot about it, but I didn't know how it worked or anything. But this was the start of a 4-year apprenticeship with this man. And it was the most amazing things that he was working with, you know. Every morning from 7 to 8 we started with not a meditation, but 1 hour where we sat and just sat in silence. And after the first, I don't know what it was, a gathering of two people sitting there in silence, later on that day I said, oh, I must remember to take a chair and put in, so we have a chair for the meditation. Meditation, he said. We don't meditate. We just sit. How little did I know that this guy, he was a former military man, you know? And the way he spoke to me, you know, I've never been attached to anything military, you know? I didn't even go to the army in Denmark. I was one of those people who said no and went otherwise. And suddenly I'm standing here with a man that's only talking to me like I was a complete, you know. Come over here, he said. Stand here. Why did I pick a piece of garbage like you? How, you know, and that was the way he spoke to me. That was the way he approached me all the time. So I mean, in one way it was really irritating. And if you knew how many times I had this, I could hit him. But on the other hand, I knew that there was something much more important going on than just being carried away by emotions. So we started every morning sitting just in silence. And after that, he went into his sessions with people who called him from all over the world. From 8 to 9 every morning, people called him from everywhere. And he started just, he did healings, he did readings, and it didn't matter if a person was living on the other side of the globe, he was able to make a precise diagnosis of this person, whatever it was, and afterwards also make the healing for this person. And sometimes, this happened a few times. For example, there was one morning a woman who had a back problem, and he said, yes, just wait a minute. And then he went, as he said, out to read the records. And he was just sitting, and then he came back. Yes, don't panic now, because there's no doubt that you have a cancer. Don't panic. Go to the doctors, get an X-ray, and phone me next week, and we'll fix it. But don't panic. Of course, he was panicked. And next week, he phoned. Yes, you're right. I have a cancer. Didn't I tell you not to panic? We'll fix it. The week after, it was gone. You know. So that was the way he worked. You know. And I think that the most important thing about his healings and his, I never ever witnessed him cheat on anybody or take the easy path or anything. If he had a commitment 10 minutes past 10 and we were driving on the worst road of all in Spain, where you absolutely don't go out and park in the shoulders. He did that if that was necessary, and it was that the right time he did that. And when he was always, his kind of ethical side was, I mean, sublime. So the ethics of it was really, you should remember, all the years I worked with him, I waited for him to give me the recipe, you know? And after 4 years, I came in Spain, that was where he lived in Spain. I came into his office, and there was a bag there, a leather bag on his on the table. And he said, yeah, now Lars, you have to go back to Denmark and start work as a healer. Not that you're going to work as a healer one-to-one forever, but you have to do this for a certain kind of a period now in order to learn the last part of what I have to learn you. And all the time when he was talking, I was completely convinced that in that bag, the recipe left it good. So I just waited, almost couldn't wait for him to stop talking so I could go into my room and open it. And when I came in, of course, it was empty. That was kind of him telling me, now you have to fill it up with your own experiences. And that's the 7 years I spent afterwards working as a healer. I mean, it's the best years of my life. I learned so much from that, from other people, just sitting there, thousands of people coming in. And at the same time, I wrote the old manuscript, the three books that make out the old manuscript. So that was a very, very fantastic period in my life. But there's so many stories about Seer, and of course, if you have some questions, I would be glad to answer them. But what I really think is most important at the time we are living in, and which what is connected exactly to, especially to the Seer's work and what he really wanted to tell everybody, is that we are all enlightened. We just have to wake up and accept it and start living as we were enlightened beings. And of course that's very easy for him to say, but if we start to just to think a little bit about what is in those words, I think we will understand how we come into this world, and very, very quickly when we come into this world, we start building up the defense system. And we have a lot of, what do you call it, resistance towards the spiritual thing, not on an idea level, because we can be very, very attached or attracted to spiritual work, and at the same time carry around something that says are doing the complete opposite. So what he really wanted, and we were three pupils, two women and I, and I never met them before, after his death, but what he wanted to really to tell us was that it can be done. You can connect to the Book of Life within half a minute. It's only to do with giving up the resistance and accept who you really are. And it sounds so simple, and yet at the same time it's so difficult to understand. And that's what most people, because I think maybe, and I think because that was something that I myself nourished for many years, the more complicated the better. If it's not complicated, it's not good enough. It must be very, very secret. So secret that only a very, very few people know about it. And in fact, we know about it. Everybody knows about it. But no one dare to believe, really believe in it so strongly that they also are unfolding it in their own lives. So how do we go about it? Of course, firstly, on a idea plane, on the planes of ideas, to mentally understand what we are talking about. But when that's understood, we must give up the mental thing about it, because most people think that you cannot go any further than the mental plane. But actually, there's so many higher planes, and that's really something. Something that we have to deal with. This is something that is so. That's really the opponent that we have to fight. The thing that we have to break down, and while we are just taking part of everyday life, most people, they just build up their defense system. So our hearts are becoming like stone, you know? And that is really what we should work on. You know, my dear friend Leonard Cohen, he had this wonderful words that there's a crack in everything, that's where the light gets in. But you know, it's a beautiful line, and I wish I had written it. But on the other hand, the line should go like this: there is a crack in everything, that's where the light gets out, you know, because that's the truth. The other thing is a very, very nice song, and a very, very poetic, two poetic lines. But if you remember what one of the masters said, you can read it in the New Testament. Remember, the kingdom of heaven is inside of you.
Wow.
So we are carrying that light within us. So we have really, when we have a broken heart, it's a gift from heaven, because then we can open up and the light can start shining from within. And that is the secret. That is the only secret. And it's not a secret anymore, because so many people are experiencing in their own life. And the next thing, when this is happening, you should also imagine, when this happened to a lot of people who phoned up the seer, for example, a man, he could phone him up and said, oh, it's terrible, my wife has left it. I have lost my job and all my money, and I'm completely, and he said, oh, calm down, congratulations, dear friend, you are in the best situation of all. This is surely a gift from God, so you are very, very lucky. And of course, this guy couldn't understand a thing, you know. But I think that what happened to me was that because I was deaf, dumb, and couldn't hear or see anything, the board upstairs there said, "Oh, this is one of the heavy ones. We have to lie him down in order to wake him up," you know. And I think that's what's happening to a lot of people, that we have to meet certain circumstances in order to wake up, you know. You know, the archangel Uriel is really that energy that is the big pedagogue of this universe. And it means, Uriel really means the fire of God. It's a great cleanser and a great awakener. And the pain is the messenger, and the message is wake up. Gift from heaven, wake up. So this is something that he really worked with the seer on an active plane. So he really wanted to set people in situations in order for them to really wake up. Not because he said so, or because they could go and read it in a book. Because they experienced it, you know. As he said, the seer, if you want to learn to ride a bike, you don't go and take a book and open it and read about how you do it. If you really want to learn to ride a bike, you must hop on the bike and start practicing. The traffic rules, on the other hand, you can read all about them. And the spiritual traffic rules are all over here. We are surrounded by traffic rules. So he talked about experience. Your experience are so much more than any book you can go and take from these. I shouldn't say it, because of course there is one book you must read. But I think you know what I'm talking about, because I can see on you here that also you are working, trying to get so experienced that we can ride that bike without falling off all the time. Hello, welcome. Actively to learn to connect is exactly the same, to start working with that. He said also many times, if you don't use your intuition, it won't use you. If you don't connect it, it won't connect you. So in many ways, when I met the seer, I have been working with the Aramaic language for many years, you know, the sacred language of Jesus. And all the deep, deep sacred psychology that lies behind that language. And in many ways, I found that there were so many similarities between this study and the work of the seer. And of course, until I found out that this is the kind of sacred science that is like a red thread through any spiritual tradition of the old spiritual traditions. And if you know about the Hermetic tradition, that is really the tradition that lies behind Christianity and Zarathustra, and also behind the work of the seer. Without him knowing it, he was a true Hermetic philosopher and healer and stuff like that. And if you read the old Hermetical scriptures, you can probably find them here, you will read some very, very inspirational pieces. Like, for example, humans are able to do anything they want. If you choose to leave this universe and look on this universe from without, from outside, you are able to do it. You can go wherever you want, whenever you want. If you collect everything, physical, psychological, mentally, spiritual, and you make it into one, then you know what God is. And if you don't know what God is, what do you have to do with God? Don't you know that you are all children of God? You know, in the Christian, the Orthodox Christianity, it said that to say like this is to be blasphemous. That's blasphemous. But if you go and read the Hermetical, it's blasphemic to not to do it. If you sit on your hands and do nothing, that is real blasphemy, you know? And you should also remember that the expression the Holy Spirit is not something that the church have invented. This is something that has been around for forever. And the Zarathustrians, the Hermetic tradition have named that thousands of years ago, before. And this tradition lived through the Essenes, you know, have heard about the Essenes and the Therapists, and in all the secret societies in Europe that have been going up, and the seer was part of that tradition without knowing it, because he was just like, you know, connecting to it every day, every day. But because he didn't read anything, he didn't know what to call it, you know, because like the Essenes, you know, themselves, you have heard about the Essenes that lived by the Dead Sea, the mystery school of Jesus. They didn't call themselves Essenes. That was something that later times called them. So what did they call themselves? They called themselves the Sons of Light, the Brotherhood of Light. And the Brotherhood and Sisterhood of Light is that club that we are all members of. You and I and everybody that is working with spirituals. So this is the real real thing that we start working. And of course we can read all those wonderful books, but maybe sometimes we should just put them away and start practicing. And bah, every day start practicing things that in order to try to connect to our own. Some will be better equipped for it right now than others will, but that doesn't matter, you know, because that's due to some other circumstances. But in the end, we will all be brilliant, not at the workshop, but in the end, before we leave this globe, if we keep on working and practicing, no doubt about it.
Jesus, for the poor were blessed, and he said he came for the brokenhearted. Is that to do with the fact that, you know, it's, the heart is sort of more, if you're poor, it can't be so encased in levels of possessions and so on, and if you're brokenhearted, it suggests what you were saying, that there might be a crack in it. Is that what he was guessing?
What Jesus was talking about, the brokenhearted, is that what we are talking about here? That this is the, what would you say? How did you put it?
Just so there be that it's broken, so there's it's in a place where it can be, it's more open and ready,
you know,
and not layers of possessions
should,
or
no. You should understand that the Essenes were masters of metaphor, really masters of metaphor. And that is something that seems to be lost for a lot of the people who are dealing with this on a university level, that these people, they were able to read between the lines of life, of everything. So they knew, when we were talking about the heart, the physical heart is just a metaphor, but what is really meant by the heart, that is the highest organ of all, because it's a spiritual organ through which you connect, you know. And when we are talking about opening up a heart or have a broken heart, it is that then the light from within shines out, and this is really the healing power that you use in everything. And when we have when we discover maybe in a healing session that things are being successful, it is due to us opening our hearts, even when we don't know that this is happening. So when we are talking about humility, you know, and to be grateful, to really practice this, to be grateful for everything we got. Not only on a mental level, because it's so easy to say, I'm very grateful for this or very good, but really feel it, you know. A lot of people are not aware that, you know, we have been visited of other civilizations for thousands of years. They come here in their funny spaceships and stuff like that, you know, primitive stuff, really, in fact. And they have been so attentive on technology, you know, in order to be able to travel through time and space, that they have completely forgot the most important thing of all, feeling, you know. And that's exactly what is beginning to happen here on Earth. We have been visited by other civilizations because that this is something they want to know from us. They want to learn this again, to relearn what they have lost, to open up our hearts. Just think, we are living in a society that gives people medicine because they feel sorrow or they are sad. You know, to be sad is a sickness. It's really, really ridiculous, you know. It's so important that we are able to express our feelings, you know? And feelings are connected to us. When we can feel things, we can feel compassionate, for example, you know, all kinds of emotions. But if we can get on top of those emotions, so we are not slaves of our emotions, but we are masters of our emotions, and we know how to open our hearts and show real compassion, that is when the healing is independent. That's all it takes. And when we say it's all it takes, it sounds so easy. And in fact, it is easy. But it doesn't seem that so many people are aware of this. So just imagine these people, they come from all over, these aliens, they come from all over in order to learn that again, you know, from us. And we are now dealing, I mean, I went to Munich a few weeks ago in order to do a workshop, and I came to the airport, and when I was taking the stairs down, I just there was a big hall. There was thousands of people, and I couldn't find one that looked up. They were all. So, just imagine that day, because that day will come, when there will be a great, huge magnetic field over Europe, and nothing of all this will work anymore. Then nobody knows anything anymore. They can't Google it. You know, we live in a time when you look out the window, oh, I wonder how the weather is today, or try and Google it, you know. Because we don't really believe in ourselves anymore. We are not connected anymore. We should remember that the word religion comes from religare, or religio, from the Latin religio, that means to reconnect to God. You know, so that's what religion is all about, to reconnect to God. So when we are talking about we are living in a society that doesn't want to have anything to do with religion, it is because they don't know what religion really is. They think it's all about suicidal bombings and stuff like that, you know. So we are here to learn to reconnect to God. And then, of course, it's up to you to find out what God is. You have a question?
Yeah.
In order to learn, you know. So you just said it. We are here in order to learn to reconnect to where we come from. You should remember in the old mystery schools, they had their first rule was that everything must return to its origin, to where it came from. And they knew that what was out there is already here. What is not here doesn't exist anywhere. So to them, it would be completely madness to put people on a rocket and send it out in the outer space in order to find life. Instead, they would put the question, if they were living here today, they would say, is there life on Earth? That would be the interesting question. Is there life on Earth? We don't know, really. We are loosening, you know. So we have to wake up and find out, exactly as you said, that we are here for a reason. And the reason is not to gain a lot of material stuff and just, and you know. So we have to experience things while we are doing it. Exactly. Yes? It is the story, I say.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
It's just as I said before, that exactly as the seer, he saw it, we are already enlightened. We just have to wake up and accept it and start acting accordingly. That's what it's all about. And to him, you know, it was really, I mean, he didn't, as I said, he never read any books, you know, so he didn't know what was, he just connected, you know, and he got some information. As he said, I don't know who I'm working for. I just get all these informations, and what more do you want from me, you know? So, but there was no doubt when, you know, I worked with him for many years, almost 10 years, that everything that I have read in other books, but especially through the Aramaic and the Yeshua and the Magdalene stuff, it was so much synchronized with everything that he did, and from the point in him where he did it, you know. So in that way, I really got what do you call proof that if you practice it in real life, the things that you were promised in the New Testament will really happen, you know. But when we're talking about being crucified, it can be in so many ways, you know. And
there's a fear, like every time I go towards my fear and I embrace my fear and go right into the eye of the fear,
yeah,
and I do one step towards the universe, the universe comes suddenly in the most magic ways, 10 steps towards me.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes, it was that I didn't take upon me my task. What I was here to do, really. You should remember, at that time when I met the seer, when I, before I was sick, I was a very successful songwriter, and I earned a lot of money. And I, you know, I have no education, because, you know, I went into the music very young. And so I earned a lot of money there, and I had an ID there. So, but nevertheless, I knew that it couldn't, I couldn't go on like this, because at the same time I was a successful songwriter, I also studied, you know, all these things, you know. So this was really the prime thing, the studies I was doing. And the other thing was just in order to have it, to be here in some way, kind of way. I never really had any musical ambition, but you know, I was so involved in it. It was, it's very hard when you, after many years, have you have reached the goal, you know, and you've earned the money, and you suddenly to turn your back towards it, you know. So, but that was the thing I had to do, and that was kind of my cross at that time. So that was very much part of the healing, that that I understood that now I must turn my back to this. And one of the lessons he gave me from that is, go back, he said, after I had worked with him the first week in Montségur, he said, now you go home and you quit show business so effectively that there's no way back. Because if you don't close the doors behind you, the doors in front of you will not open also. And I've seen that so many times for people who came to me for help, that they didn't really want to close the doors behind, or they couldn't. And therefore, they couldn't open in front of them. So there's a connection there, you know, to be precise. This is another thing about the seer. He learned us to be, try and be precise in everything you do. Say yes when you mean yes, and no when you mean no. Because if you don't, you create a lot of noise. And he also said that the environmental pollution is very, very bad, but there's a pollution, a kind of pollution that is worth thought forms, you know, that we are creating all the time. So this is something to think about. And to try and deal with. And every time one person come to terms with itself, you know, with him or herself, and every time you face yourself and you face your own shadows and you can heal them, you help a lot of other people who are dealing with the same problems that you are dealing with. And that's how we are connected, you know. So if when we are working with ourselves, this is really something that we should continue, even if other people said this is ego work, you know, it's just the ego trying to be into. But the ego is something that we should be masters of, and not vice versa. And that's where the big shift is. So yeah. Okay. If hopefully you go and see the documentary of the seer tomorrow, because some of the footage I took or filmed this guy from the very beginning when I met him is now a documentary that is shown tomorrow at I don't know where the place, it's a university. Regent's
Park. But it's booked out, isn't it?
Regent's Park. Okay. Thank you for coming. And if somebody needs a book or something, I would be pleased to
sign
put a signature.
Up for this, yeah.
Of course, yes.
And it's a special offer tonight for 25% off. So we all leave our lives, close the doors, and go out.
Yes,
and,
of course. You just follow me. You know?